Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999. A spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
Say this with me: where he leads me, I will follow. What he feeds me, I will swallow. Amen. Are you ready? Let's look at a couple things before we dig into the word. I like this. There are two times to praise God: when you feel like it and when you don't. That covers it all, doesn't it? Regardless, praise him anyhow. Amen. I will bless the Lord when? At all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I like this saying I found. Everybody has troubles, but not everybody has Jesus. Amen. Jesus makes the difference. I don't know how people that don't know him deal with life, how they cope. Well, they go to a pill, or they go to a bottle, or they go to something. I run to Jesus. Amen? Praise the Lord. This is a pretty good saying here. I don't usually brag about going to expensive places, but I just left the gas station. Woo, that hurt my wallet this week. How about this? I am proud to announce that I completed the first item on my bucket list. I have the bucket. Have you made that much progress? And here's another funny one. Anybody remember Fred G. Sanford? Anybody remember? That blank look you get when you forget what your pastor was preaching after he started chasing rabbits. I'm going to try not to chase rabbits today. So don't give me that blank look, all right? Smile once in a while. Say amen once in a while. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, I started a series a couple of Wednesday nights ago on heaven that I want to try and wrap up. Heaven, a prepared place for a prepared people. Jesus is preparing us a place in heaven. How many believe that? Simultaneously, he is preparing us for that place here on earth through the Holy Spirit. Preparation is happening in heaven and it's happening in earth. The groom is preparing the place, the bride is preparing herself. Anybody beside me getting ready to leave this world? Amen. Hallelujah. So before we get to our text here, I want to review for those of you that were not here on the last couple Wednesday nights, and for our TV audience, we want to review some of the things that we covered. This is very important ground. What is heaven anyway? Heaven is the dwelling place of God, the angels, and the spirits of the righteous after death. There's a couple of scriptures I want to throw in here. Psalm 11:4, the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. So heaven is the dwelling place of God. Here's another one. I like this. Thus saith the Lord, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. So if you wonder how big heaven is, God said it's my throne and the earth is just my ottoman where I prop my feet up. How many know we serve a mighty God? We serve a vast, great God. Amen? Hallelujah. Heaven is the final abode of all those who are redeemed by the blood of Christ and regenerated by the Holy Spirit. If you're born again, if you're saved, if you're washed in the blood, you're destined for that eternal home. How many are glad you have that hope today? So heaven is the place or the state of existence of the blessed after this mortal life. Figuratively, heaven is a place or a state of supreme happiness. Have you ever ate a brownie fudge sundae and said, oh, this is heaven. You were in hog heaven. That's figurative, all right? Praise God. Paul said that he was caught up into the third heaven. Did you know there are three heavens? Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12:2, I know a man in Christ who was caught up to the third heaven. Well, if that's the case, then it makes me wonder, well, what's heaven number one, heaven number two, and heaven number three? If there's a third heaven, let's break it down real quick. The first heaven is just earth's atmosphere, the atmosphere around the earth. That's where the birds fly and planes fly and winds blow and clouds form. And then there's the second heaven, which we would call outer space. And this blows my mind. Did you know the galaxy-filled universe of the sun, the moon, and the stars is vast? Scientists don't know everything, but they say there are somewhere between 200 billion and 2 trillion galaxies full of planets and stars. And our galaxy, the Milky Way, is just one of them. If that is the case, imagine how vast the universe is. So the second heaven is outer space. And I know, I looked this up, as of July 20th, 2021, 574 people have flown into outer space. A few more since then. And they haven't seen heaven with their natural eye, not even William Shatner, not even Captain Kirk. Because they only got to the second heaven. Then there's a third heaven. Hallelujah. I like this. The third heaven is God's dwelling place. You can't pinpoint it on a map. You won't find it on GPS. You can't get there in a rocket. You can't get there in a space shuttle. Hallelujah. But how many know one day the dead in Christ are going to rise first, and we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Hallelujah. How many have made your destination? You've made your plans. You've got a reservation. Tell somebody, I've made my reservation. Well, hallelujah. Glory to God. So those are a couple of things about heaven. Now, we know heaven is a literal place that we're going to go to in the future. We say in the sweet by and by. But I believe also you can have a little taste of heaven right here and right now. Amen. Let me give you this scripture. Ephesians 2 says this, that God, who's made us alive together with Christ, raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You didn't know it, but while we were worshiping and praising God and singing, you didn't know it, but you were being elevated into a heavenly place. Hallelujah. Yes, heaven is a literal place somewhere that we don't know about, but let me tell you, heaven can be here and now too. The presence of God, wherever God is in authority, that's where his kingdom is. That's where there's a taste of heaven. Not the full manifestation, but a little foretaste of glory divine. Thank you, Jesus. Amen? Now, going with that, let's ask this question. Is heaven literal or spiritual? The answer is yes, both. There is a literal place where those who die in the faith will go. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. So there is a literal place, but I also believe in a spiritual sense, heaven is wherever God's kingdom and his presence manifests. In fact, Jesus said it this way. He said, they'll say, lo here or lo there. He said, but listen, the kingdom of heaven is within you. That little taste of what it's going to be like on the other side. Hallelujah. All right, where is heaven? I just kind of touched on this a moment ago. Only God knows. The Bible does not specify where heaven is located. We generally assume heaven is up, geographically speaking, but I think it's up in another way. I think it's up dimensionally. It's higher than, it's greater than anything we have ever experienced in this world. In fact, Paul the Apostle said, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for those that love him. My, what a home awaits the child of God. He's preparing the place, but he's preparing us for the place. Amen? And that goes back to what Jesus said in the Gospel of John. We're all familiar with this. In John chapter 14, one of the most famous passages of Scripture in the Bible, John 14, 1, it says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Here's what Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions, the King James. Other versions say many dwelling places, many rooms. The Greek word, by the way, is monae. That's what I need, some more monae. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Here's what he said. Here's the promise of a place. I go to prepare a what? A place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, here's the plan. All right, so you got the promise of a place. Here's the second part. You've got the promise of a plan. If I go prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. How many glad there's a plan? There's a place and there's a plan to get you to that place. Hallelujah. And here's what the next part. Well, Thomas says, well, Lord, how can we know the way? Jesus said, it's real simple, fellas. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. He didn't say I am a way. He said I am the way. There's the promise of a place, there's a promise of a plan to get you to that place, and there's a path, hallelujah, that's been made clear, that straight and narrow way of following Jesus. Praise the Lord. I've told this story many times. I love to tell it. Billy Graham was in a small town years ago holding a little revival, a little crusade, and he needed to find the post office. So he was out in his car driving down the road, unfamiliar with where he was going, trying to find the post office. A little boy was riding on his bicycle. Billy Graham pulled over the side of the road, rolled down the window. He said, "Hey, buddy," he said, "hey, can you help me find the post office?" "Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Go down this road, turn right, down on the left. No problem. You'll see it." Billy Graham said to him, he said, "Son," he said, "while we're at it," he said, "I want you to invite your mom, your dad, your friends, all your neighbors, invite them. We're having a crusade at the Civic Center, and we're telling people how to find heaven." That boy looked at him weird and said, "Mister," said, "if you don't know how to find the post office, how in the world do you know how to find heaven?" How many glad you know how to find heaven? I said, you know how to find heaven. Jesus said, "I am the door. By me, if any man entered in, he shall be saved." Glory to God. Now, the greatest descriptions of heaven are in the book of Revelation. That's why I had you turn to Revelation 21. We're going to read some. But John does not necessarily call it heaven. He calls it something else. He describes heaven as a city. He describes it as New Jerusalem. But that's not all there is to heaven. Think about it this way. Let me ask you this question. Is Washington, D.C., is that America? Well, yes and no. It's in America, but it's not all of America, is it? It's just the capital city. Is New Jerusalem all there is to heaven? I believe it's just the capital city. And how vast it is, you're going to see here in just a moment. Let's read a few verses. Revelation 21, is this interesting to you? Look at verse 1. "Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also there was no more sea." Why do we need a new heaven? Because heaven has been defiled by Satan's rebellion. Unregenerated man has looked up into the heavens and cursed God. So heaven has been defiled. We know this world has been contaminated by sin. And so guess what? God's going to start all over again with a new heaven and a new earth. Praise God. Then he describes it. Verse 2. "Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, come down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself shall be with them and shall be their God." And I love verse 4 and 5. "And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death." Say it. No more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make" what? "All things new." Praise God. Glance over at verse 10, if you will. It says, "And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God." So I view the New Jerusalem as kind of the capital city of heaven. There's a whole lot more to it, but what a description he gives us. I'm not going to read it. But from verses 10 all the way down through verses 21, it's a detailed description of the New Jerusalem. Think about it this way. When God comes back, he's bringing a whole new city with him. He's bringing heaven down to earth. Hallelujah. Now, let me show you this. This is the same city that the patriarchs looked for. They sought for it through their pilgrimages. Hebrews 11, 9 and 10, look at this with me. "By faith, Abraham sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles or tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise." Say it with me. "For he looked for" what? "A city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God." He never found that city. He died in faith looking for that city. Hallelujah. How many know one day we're going to experience what it is to live in that city? A city wherein dwells righteousness. Praise God. Now we know the old Jerusalem was David's capital city. That's where he moved the Ark of the Covenant. That's where Solomon built the temple. the old Jerusalem, I like the definition or the meaning, Jerusalem means possession of peace, which is a little ironic. Because how many of you know Jerusalem is one of the most war-torn cities in the world? The Muslims want it. The Jews want it. The Christians want it. And there's been this struggle through the ages to try and capture and maintain that city. Well, let me tell you, there'll never be true peace in Jerusalem, the city of peace, until the Prince of Peace comes and rules on his rightful throne. Hallelujah. How many are glad you have the Prince of Peace in your heart? Amen. There may be chaos in the world, but you can have peace in your mind and peace in your heart if the Prince of Peace is ruling in your life. Amen. Well, I'm about to preach myself happy up here. Glory to God. You can have that blank face like Fred G. Sanford, or you can say amen, brother. Hallelujah. Jerusalem will finally experience peace when the Prince of Peace comes back to rule over it. I've been to a lot of big cities. I've been to Miami. I've been to New York 3 times. I've been to Chicago several times. I've been to Atlanta, Indianapolis, Baltimore, Dallas. I've been to Mexico City. I've been to Moscow. I've been to D.C. None of them will hold a candle to the New Jerusalem. None of them will hold a candle to the New Jerusalem. And listen, the old Jerusalem was once the headquarters of God on earth, where the Ark of the Covenant was, where the temple was. But when God comes back with New Jerusalem, it will be heaven on earth for 1,000 years and beyond. To look at somebody and say, I want to go there, don't you? Let me give you a little, comparison here. The Bible gives us the dimensions of that city, whether it's literal, whether it's figurative, I don't know. You can fuss about it. I'm not going to. I'm just going to thank God it's coming. All right, verse 16 says they measured the New Jerusalem. It was 1,500 miles wide, 1,500 miles tall, 1,500 miles long. Imagine that cube sitting on top of the United States right there. And that's roughly the dimensions of that city. That's a big city. And that's probably just the capital of heaven. Whew. Notice this, the only other cube mentioned in the Bible is the Holy of Holies. In Moses' tabernacle, there was the Holy of Holies. It was 10 cubits long, 10 cubits wide, 10 cubits tall. A perfect cube. And that's where the Shekinah glory of God hovered over the Ark of the Covenant. So if heaven is a cube, much bigger cube, then the Holy of Holies, what does that say? Hallelujah. You've got the equal Father, the equal Son, the equal Holy Spirit. Their presence is pervasive throughout. That's when you've got the Shekinah glory of God living and dwelling among men. Hallelujah. Woo, hallelujah. What a glorious future awaits the child of God. Now, I don't have time to go into all these details, but I do want you to know, we talk about streets of gold, right? We talk about walls of jasper, gates of pearl, streets of gold, right? Well, I do want to make this one quick observation. I want you to see this. Verse 18, it's not just streets of gold. The construction of its wall was of jasper, and the city was pure gold like clear glass. Not just streets of gold, the whole city was gold. You heard about the guy who saved up all his money before he died, and he got all his money converted into gold, and he had this big satchel, this duffel bag full of gold bars. When he died, he went to heaven, and he got to the gate, and the angel said, "What you got there in the bag, buddy?" He said, "Oh, yeah, this is everything I saved my whole life. Look at here, my gold bars." And the angel looked down and said, "Oh, pavement. We got plenty of that around here." What does it profit to gain the whole world and lose your soul? You're not taking it with you, my friend. Hallelujah. You might as well lay up some treasure in heaven. Send it on ahead. Amen. Praise God. But there he was thinking he had something, and it was just pavement. And whether it's the same kind of gold we know here in this world or not, I don't know. John is trying to describe something heavenly, and the only way he can describe it is to compare it to things that we know here on earth. It may be something even better than gold that we're not even aware of. But he said that city looked like it was gold, the whole thing. Hallelujah. not anything inferior. It's not made of wood. It's not made of stone. It's not made of concrete or marble or asphalt or tile or vinyl. The whole city, he said, was gold. Whew, hallelujah. Praise his name. So there's a lot more about that city we'll discuss probably Wednesday night. I just want to hit the highlights here. The second description he gives of heaven is as a bride, which speaks of perfect preparation. Look at verse 2 again, if you will. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared how? As a what? A bride adorned for her husband. Look at verse 9 again. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls filled with the seven last plagues came to me, and he talked with me, saying, come, I will show you what? The bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away into the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me. He didn't see a woman. What did he see? He saw a city. So he compared New Jerusalem, the capital of heaven, to the Lamb's wife. Emily was in a wedding yesterday. We were over at the venue where Nathan and Emma got married 2.5 years ago. It's called Creekside Meadow, and it was just an elegant, just a beautiful wedding. And Emily was a bridesmaid in that, and I got to thinking about how much preparation goes into a wedding. There's a lot to it. How many of you ladies remember the day you got married and all the stuff that had to be done and all the days and weeks and months ahead of time you were preparing? Think of what goes into it. You got to have matching clothes, the wedding dress, the hair, the makeup, the flowers, the jewelry, the nails, the music, the food, the place settings, the decor, the cake, all of this stuff, the beverages, the venue, all of this stuff, because every detail. You want it to be that when the bride walks down the aisle, she looks perfect and captures the eye and the heart of her groom. Anybody in here getting ready? Anybody in here getting ready to meet your heavenly bridegroom? Hallelujah. Listen, when he says, I'll show you the Lamb, the bride's wife, and then he shows a city, realize this, a city is made up of more than just buildings and roads. A city consists of the inhabitants, the occupants, the citizens of that city. God's bride is not a building. God's bride is his people. Hallelujah. Let me give you another passage. If you back up in the book of Revelation, a chapter or two, here's what you'll find. Revelation 19, 7 through 9. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife, here it is, hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And he said unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. Woo, hallelujah. The wedding was good, but boy, that reception was wonderful too. Hallelujah. How many know we're headed for a wedding? Jesus' ministry started at a wedding. His first miracle was at the wedding of Cana in John, what is it, 2 or 3? But guess what? It's all going to culminate in another wedding, our wedding. By the way, the creator of the universe is in love. Look at somebody say, with you. The creator of the universe is in love. Squire Parsons wrote a song in 1973. This was 48 years ago. How many know this song? Beulah Land. I'm longing for you. Beulah Land. Where my home shall be eternal. Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land. Where does that come from? Where does that idea come from? I'm so glad you asked, because I'm going to tell you. Hallelujah. It comes from Isaiah chapter 62, verse 4 and 5. Listen to this passage. You shall no longer be termed forsaken, speaking of Israel, and your land shall no longer be termed desolate, but you shall be called Hephzibah, which means my delight is in her. And your land shall be called Beulah, which means married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. What is heaven? It's when God is married to his people. Unbroken fellowship, no barriers, no distance, hallelujah, but a total love relationship. Listen, this is not about dead religion, folks. This is not about duty and obligation and drudgery. Oh no, this should be a delight. It's a love relationship. Hallelujah!
Look at this. The next verse there in Isaiah. Isaiah 62, verse 5. Look what it says. As a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so I, your God, will rejoice over you. Whew. Talk about being happy to see you. God's going to be happy to see you. He is head over heels in love with his people. No wonder Jesus said, no good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. You love to bless your kids, don't you? You're already ordering Christmas stuff off Amazon. Let me tell you, God's already got stuff prepared for you like nothing this world can offer. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All right, let's move on and try to wrap this up and land this plane. Praise God. Heaven is also depicted as a tabernacle or a temple. Notice this. Chapter 21 and verse 2. No, verse 3, I'm sorry. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God. What's he talking about? He's talking about Moses' tabernacle. This tent-like structure. God said this, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. The only problem was there were barriers. They had curtains. They had a veil. They could only stay in the outer court. Only the priest could go into the holy place. Only the high priest could go into the holy of holies one time of year. And now he says, listen, the temple, the tabernacle of God is with men. And here's the good news. There won't be any barriers. How many are glad Jesus, hallelujah, broke down the middle wall of partition? How many are glad the veil was ripped in two? Hallelujah. And we have unlimited access to the presence of God. That's what heaven will be like. Unbroken fellowship with God. No barriers. And then look at this. This is powerful. Look at verse 22. And I saw no temple in it. For the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. Did you know there won't be any churches in heaven? Amen. Won't need them. It'll be church 24/7. Uninterrupted praise, uninterrupted fellowship. Hallelujah. See, God, he's not just interested in visitation. His whole plan from the beginning was habitation. Somebody said it this way. It was a clever way to help us understand it. God doesn't want just visitation rights on the weekend. He wants full custody. How many lift your hand and say, Lord, I give you full custody. My whole life is yours. Everything. Hallelujah. So he compares heaven to a temple or a tabernacle. Praise God. And we know that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Here's that scripture again. But I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. Praise God. Here's the next way he describes it. He describes heaven as a garden. And I believe this is part of the restoration of what it was like in the Garden of Eden. We've had the curse has been broken through the blood of Jesus Christ, and there has been partial restoration. But I'm looking for the day when there's total restoration. Let's read that scripture, Revelation 22. Here's what it says. He showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, on either side of the river, was there a tree of life which bore 12 fruits, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. You've got the water of life and you've got the tree of life. Everything you need to drink, everything you need to eat, total provision. You won't have to go to Walmart anymore. You won't have to go to the grocery store. Praise God. You won't have to worry about your debit card working at the Dollar General. Hallelujah. Or should I say the Good Springs Galleria. Praise God. Everything you need will be provided. Everything you need will be furnished. Hallelujah. That's what heaven is. No lack, no need, no want. Everything met because of the God you serve. Well, hallelujah. All right, you can make a lot longer list. I'm just going to scan through this real quick. There's 10 things at least. There'll be no more in heaven. No more sea. No more death. No more sorrow. No more crying. No more pain. No more curse. No more night. No more devil. No more evil. No more sickness or disease. How many say, I want to go there? I want to go there. Well,
Here's the good news. There's an open invitation to everybody. Revelation 22, 17. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him that hears say, come. Let him who is athirst come. And finish it with me. And whosoever will. Look at somebody and say, you're a whosoever. Let him come and take of the water of life freely. Here's the good news. Listen, if you go to a ball game, guess what you got to have to get in? If you go to a movie, what do you got to have? If you go to a concert, what do you have to have? You do anything, you have to have a ticket. Well, here's the good news. Your ticket has already been bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. But here's the thing. It does you no good unless you repent, unless you believe, and unless you accept what he has done. Praise God. Thank God for that ticket. Heaven, don't miss it for the world. Now here's a sobering question. I'm finishing. I'm wrapping up. Will everyone go to heaven? Does God want everybody to go to heaven? It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Will everybody go to heaven? There is a prevailing belief system right now. It's called universalism. That everybody will eventually go to heaven. Doesn't matter what you believe. Doesn't matter how you live. Doesn't matter which religion you take. It's all different paths of the same God. That's what the world is promoting right now. That is not what the Bible teaches. That is not what Jesus said. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. Think of it this way. Can you get on a plane at any gate going any direction and get to New York? You got to get on a specific plane at a specific gate going a specific direction if you want to reach the right destination. Well, how many know Jesus has already made the way? I said, Jesus has already made the way. Praise God. Now, let me close with this now. Look at Revelation 21. Who's going to be there? Who's going to be in this new Jerusalem? Who's going to be saved? Or who's going to be included? It tells us right here, verse 24, and the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the king of the earth shall bring their glory and honor to it. Verse 27, but there shall by no means enter into anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written where? In the Lamb's book of life. God wants everyone to go to heaven, but it's your choice. Listen, your eternal destiny is not a chance. It's your choice. It's your choice. And I love the way that it's put in Acts 4:12. He said, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Another scripture, 1 Timothy 2:5 says this, for there is one God, everybody say one God, and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. You can't go your own way, you've got to go God's way. And he's already made it available. Isn't that good news? I want to see every one of you in heaven. I want to see every one of you in heaven. Amen? Tell somebody, I plan to be there. And I'm going God's way. Amen? Will you stand with me?
Honey, I'd like us to sing that chorus.
Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry, which debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama, 35502. If we can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey, please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's Word works.